I'm delighted to welcome Leah on back to Dawn Osborne in session. Leah, let everyone know how you are.
I'm on the west coast of Canada and I'm doing fantastic. There's actually like a slight bit of sunshine today, so that's a good thing.
Okay, yeah, it was very nice weather in London today as well. Now, Leah, during lockdown, you recorded a Christmas album. Give us the background to that.
So the Christmas album was actually recorded in a bit of a hurry in 2020. You know, when we first went into lockdown, I think everybody was sort of scrambling to figure out like, where am I at? What am I doing? How do we repurpose our activities to suit this new reality, right? And so we did a few of those like rocking from home videos where we're all in like various, like the Hollywood squares, you know, and then we're all performing together. And then we did a few of those. And then in around September 2020, my guitarist Sean phoned me from Toronto and he said, you know what we should do? We should do a Christmas album. Because we talked about doing a Christmas album so many times, and we just, for various reasons, you know, you get busy with life, we had gigs coming up, we had other recording we were doing, songwriting, we just never got around to it. And I said, that is such a cool idea, you know, and I think at that time we really needed it to lift our spirits. We wanted a project that could lift our spirits, but also lift the spirits of our fans. And so we set to mind that we were going to do this Christmas album in a hurry. And so in about 6 weeks' time, we selected the songs. I curated the list. We put it all together. We recorded it all in our home studios, threw it all together, and we put it out as a little independent release last year. And then this year, when we were signing the deal for Radio One with Metal Villain out of Germany, the interest was expressed that, you know, what about releasing this again next year globally? Because really, it was just really, we pushed sales off our website last year, but it wasn't like readily available in Sweden and Japan and every other place, right? And so we thought that's a really cool idea, but we wanted to make it very special. So what we did is in February of last year, we wrote two brand new Christmas originals. So very excited about those. There's a song called Almost Christmas, which we purposely did because we wanted it to reflect the song, the album title. And we wrote a song called More Fun on the Naughty List, which is a naughty little rock and roll song. It's quite fun. So those are the two new tracks. And we released it with a new cover. So, yeah, it's all very exciting. We're getting some really, really positive feedback on it. And this year we brought in our videographer, our video editing guy, Frank Greiner, brought him on board to put together a couple of videos as well for the album. So exciting.
Yeah. No, actually, I wanted to ask about the videos because they're absolutely lovely. I mean, you know, they're just top notch. They're not the kind of lockdown video you were talking about. They're really high production values and very cute. So tell people a little bit more about each of the songs in the videos and the videos themselves.
Well, Almost Christmas, that video hasn't been released yet. That is coming this Friday. So I don't want to give away too much, but I almost look at him a bit like a fifth band member at this point in time. We have a lovely friend in Toronto. His name is Frank Greiner. He's done some amazing work, even just recently for Def Leppard. He does all of their videos and digital work now. Incredibly, incredibly talented young man. And so I called him up a couple months ago and I said, look, I really think it'd be fun to put together a couple of videos for the global release of this album this year. And so Frank actually brainstormed the ideas. The label wanted to put out Everything's Gonna Be Cool This Christmas. And we had the idea of a driving video. Wouldn't it be cool to make it look like I'm driving through the Canadian North? So what I can tell you about that video, it was actually filmed in my driveway in my little car. But Frank took all that footage and he made it look like I'm bombing through the Canadian North, the hinterland. And so I really can't take much credit at all for that video other than the footage, the self-filmed footage which was done with an iPhone 12. And then Frank took all that footage and he made it look amazing. And it made it look like I was traveling through the Canadian North, which is just right now, it would be very hard to film something like that. But he has his mysterious and magical ways. And so he did that.
And it was beautiful. The reflection in the little mirror was just beautiful as well, wasn't it? You know,
That was Frank's idea. So he sent me a shot list and he said, I need you to film yourself like this. I need you to tape your iPhone to the rear view mirror and film yourself that way. And I'm like, okay, because I have this rear view mirror idea. So I really can't take a lot of credit other than filming self-footage, which I think a lot of people are doing right now during COVID, and it's still difficult to assemble an entire crew to do stuff like this. And especially we're kind of a bi-coastal band. We got, you know, Sean's in Toronto, the rest of us are on the West Coast. And so Frank did that. The other video that we put together last year for It Doesn't Often Snow at Christmas, which I think you remember was a Pet Shop Boys song, which we did a rock and roll version of that, which was so fun. We all filmed ourselves individually and sent all the footage to Frank, and he pieced it together, and he had it added all those interesting digital artifacts like the Christmas lights and the Bing Crosby album flying around, and you know, he did that stuff. So again, I can't take much credit other than I chose to subcontract him to do our work because he's so talented. You know, he's an amazing talent. And the Almost Christmas video, which is coming this Friday, which again I'm very excited about. There's some superimposed footage of me, but largely it is a lyric video that it takes place with lyrics being projected onto a gigantic road case that's in a big red Christmas ribbon, and it spins around and does some interesting things. So that's coming on Friday.
Okay. Well, I look forward to seeing it because the others were absolutely lovely and you look amazing in them as well. It's really, really, really nice. Now, there are 9 other songs on the album that are not the 2 originals that you mentioned, and they're from the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. Most of the songs, they're lesser known Christmas songs, really. They're not the obvious ones. They're really cool songs, and you've rocked them up. And I really like the selection of them.
So what I can tell you about that list is that when Sean and I had the discussion around doing a Christmas album, again, there was not a lot of time for us to really labor over this. And I said to my husband, I got to figure out what we're going to do for this album in the next, you know, over the weekend. So let's sit down together. So the lovely thing is my husband is a musicologist and an avid collector. I think you're aware of that. Has over 200,000 pieces of vinyl. And he also has a lot of those albums, well, most of those albums on a digital list on multiple hard drives that are attached to his computer. So we just started going through stuff alphabetically and looking at songs. And every time we landed on something that really resonated with me, I was like, ooh, I like the Eels tune, the Everything's Gonna Be Cool This Christmas. I'd actually never heard that song before. Mm-hmm. And my husband played it for me. And I was like, I love that Mark Everett song. It's amazing. I can totally see my band doing this. So it was really just about which tracks resonated with me. The Over the Rhine song, which is almost like a smoky blues tune, mm-hmm. was something that I had been one of my favorite Christmas songs. It is a lesser known tune. It had always been on my list of favorites and I always wanted to cover it. So I decided to put it on the album. I love old jazz and blues. So to do an old Louis Armstrong tune was just right in my wheelhouse. The thing is, you know, our approach with some of those tracks was a little more like Brian Setzer rock and rockabilly orchestra kind of vibe, right? So we put our signature stamp on everything, which was the Lee Aaron rock and roll, you know, stamp. It's done by the band. And, you know, even though the songs are pulled from different genres of music, you know, this is the history of rock and roll, right? So I think it all works as a cohesive cohesive piece of work, right? So I'm really pleased with the Christmas album, and the feedback we've got last year and that we're getting this year is just that people love it, you know?
Yeah. No, it's, I think you are a bit of a perfectionist, and you've done a great job. And you know, Baby Jesus Born to Rock, you know, I mean, that's just so you. I mean, it's just so you. Yeah, that was absolutely wonderful. Now, a couple of the tunes though are really well known. I mean, Merry Christmas, Everybody is a brave choice because it's almost like a sacred thing in the UK, that song. So almost nobody ever covers it. So that was quite a brave choice.
Well, interestingly enough, the gentleman that owns and runs Music Express Canada, it was sort of like the Rolling Stone of Canada for the longest time. It used to be a print magazine. It's now online. His name is Keith Sharp, and he's a Brit. And he's been a wonderful friend of mine for about 35 years. And when I sent him the Christmas album last year, he wanted to review it for Music Express. And he said the exact same thing. He said, whoa, I'm a little nervous to listen to this because it's like almost like sacrilege trying to do that song. And I have to tell you, when I first heard it, I love that song. It's not a classic in Canada the way it is in the UK. Okay. But yeah, to try to emulate Naughty Holder, you know, when I first heard it, I went like, I just don't have that kind of immense thickness and power in my voice. And I'm like, how can I pull this off and make this a success, this song? So I double tracked my voice through the whole song, which made it work. And when I said to the guys in the band, you know, when we first recorded those background vocals, I was like, you know, they're not right. I have to erase them. I said, we have the trick to making this song sound authentic. We have to sound like we're all having a beer in a pub and we're just sitting around and singing this like a bunch of jolly old dudes having a pint, right?
Yeah.
And so that's what we did. We got around a mic, me and Dave Reimer, and I said, okay, we're going to pretend like we're drunk people in a pub and let's sing this chorus. And so we did it a little bit sloppy, intentionally, to make it sound authentic. And then I was like, okay, that's it. We got it. That is what makes this tune authentic. And when I sent it to Sean in Toronto, I said, dude, have a couple drinks and sing the chorus and send it back. I, you know, my friend Keith, who is a Brit, you know, through and through, and said the same thing as you. He said, you did it. You pulled it off. And he was really happy with the tune. So I was like, ha, okay. I got the stamp of approval from Keith, so I'm okay. Yeah.
And the other one that's really well known on there is Run, Run, Rudolph, which I think is one of the best Christmas songs, actually. You know, for one of the sort of ones that is played a lot, it's one of the best of the ones that you hear a lot on, you know. I think it also lends itself really well to being rocked up as well.
Well, it's a Chuck Berry rock and roll song, right?
Yeah.
That was when, you know, when my modus operandi behind doing this album was nobody wants to hear Lee Aaron sing, you know, Silent Night again. Like, to do an album that's all traditional covers, I thought, for me, was a mistake and not authentic. But we didn't want to completely alienate people by having so many unknown songs that it wouldn't be relatable. So we did decide to put a couple of more well-known songs on. So Run, Run, Rudolph was one of my choices. Zat You, Santa Claus, that's a fairly well-known Louis Armstrong tune. And of course, Merry Christmas, Everybody is very well-known. So
Yeah.
And then we recorded Peace on Earth to do something just, you know, well-known for Lee Aaron fans, but a little bit different. And that was really, that was a fun challenge as well. So,
because it wasn't a Christmas song to start with, although it was kind of adopted as this kind of Christmas song because of the theme. But you've re-recorded it, and to me, it sounds less rocky than the original.
Well, I think, and yeah, you are right. My idea was to give that song a little more nuance and a little more tenderness in the re-recording. because it is a very serious subject matter. It was, you're right, it's been picked up over the years. It gets played again and again at Christmas time because it's a message of hope, right? Of universal hope. And the original was recorded, obviously, in the early 90s with early 90s production values. And I think that the original is a bit more, if I can say this in a nice way, a little more bombastic. And I thought that giving the song a little more of a sensitive treatment was appropriate for this album. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's good to have a new version as well. I mean, you know, obviously people, yeah, there's something extra on the album. Now, I do want to ask you some general questions about Christmas. Sure. So what's a typical Christmas for you?
A typical Christmas in the last few years since I've had children is we get together with my husband's side of the family because they live on the West Coast. My family lives out East. So sometimes I'll fly back East and visit them pre-Christmas or after Christmas, but not since COVID, unfortunately. So we get together. It's a large gathering. We rotate between my sister-in-law's home and my home. I'm hosting this year, and I'm really looking forward to that. I love hosting. I love decorating, but I have a rule in my house. My kids, the moment Halloween is done, they want to put up Christmas direct decorations, and I'm like, no, just go to the dollar store. You can see them all, you know, because they got them out the second Halloween is over. So I have a December 1st rule before we pull out our tree and our Christmas decorations. We wait till December. I love decorating. You know, we have a little village that we set up on a table, all that kind of stuff. And the other thing that we do, rather than we used to do everybody buying a Christmas present for everybody in the family, with my extended family, we don't do that anymore. What we do now is we started the crazy gift exchange where we all throw in a either recycled secondhand or a re-gifted gift that is maybe not useful to us, but useful to someone else. We try to be green about it. And so we wrap them all up and we put them in a crazy gift exchange where you choose numbers and then you take a gift. And then if you like the other person's, when your number's up, if you like somebody else's gift better, you can steal their gift or pick their gift. And then we do another round of gift stealing, which is gets really crazy and fun. And sometimes these gifts are completely wacky, you know, like they're either something that is very coveted or something that nobody else would really want, you know. So it goes on for about an hour and a half, and it's one of the funnest parts of Christmas for us because, again, it's about connecting family, about exchanging these crazy gifts, about stealing gifts from your, you know, and sometimes your guy, okay, if you want your allowance next week, you go steal that gift from mom when your number is up, you know. I want that teapot, you know. So it's just a crazy thing we do. And then our own family, our immediate family, of course, Santa comes. And Christmas Eve, we have a tradition of going out for dinner. So we always find a restaurant that's open and we go out for dinner as a family so that I don't have to cook. And then we come back. We usually drive around and see all the Christmas light displays locally as a family and listen to Christmas music and come back and then watch a Christmas film and watch the Santa tracker So it's very, very, do you guys have Santa Tracker?
No, what is that?
Oh my gosh. Well, you got to go on there. It's like the North Pole online, and you can see, you watch on, there's a GPS that shows you exactly where Santa is in the world, dropping off his gifts.
You know, my kids
aren't as into it now as they were when they were younger. I used to use it as leverage. I'm like, oh, Santa's almost in Newfoundland. You got to go to bed now because he's going to be here in a couple hours. Get to bed now. And then when you finally get them in bed, you finally get those kids in bed. My husband and I are like, whew, after we get all the presents under the tree, then we relax and have a glass of wine. That's Christmas for us.
Sounds lovely. What's the best Christmas present that you've ever had?
Well, I have to tell you, to be honest with you, the best Christmas present I've ever received is this year. And I can tell you, I think I might have spoken to you about this when we spoke last time. We live on a large property, and right now we are currently surrounded. I'm surprised you can't hear tractors and trucks outside. I am surrounded by a Bob the Builder scene right now around my home. They are developing all around me, the surrounding land. We have kind of been, and the reason we didn't want to move for so long is because my husband, we built a custom build onto our home that houses my husband's immense music library. It doubles as a rehearsal space for my band and a studio. We didn't want to move because we love our home, but we've been really inched out by encroaching development. And literally 2 weeks ago, we sold our property and we bought a new house. And it's the most beautiful house I could have ever imagined buying. And I said to my husband, you'd never have to get me another Christmas present for the rest of my life because I have my dream house now.
So, oh, that's brilliant. That's a really good question to ask then.
Yes, it's the best Christmas present I could have ever gotten. I cannot wait to move our family in there in the new year. And I mean, I've got like a chef's kitchen. I'm so excited.
And what's your, talking of kitchens, what's your favorite Christmas food?
My favorite Christmas food would be, I mean, I like the traditional stuff, but chocolate, of course, is all, but what is it? It's British. It's the jelly stuff. What is it?
Trifle?
Not trifle. It is, you know, Chronicles of Narnia. What's the forbidden candy? I'm trying to remember.
Marzipan.
You know what? I'm having a total brain fart right now, and I can't remember. It's a British. It's like a candied jelly treat. What is it called?
I don't know. We'll have to have a competition. Somebody to guess.
I'm a complete idiot right now because I can't remember. It's my favorite candy. I'm looking at
candied peel. Candied peel?
No. British jelly treat. What's it called? It's not. I'll think of it and I'll send it you the link.
Well, please, we'll have to have a competition for everybody to guess. And do you ever do any New Year's resolutions?
No.
I don't really either.
Not really officially. All my friends and family know this, and my work colleagues know this about me. I'm a project-oriented person in the first place. So I always have a project. I don't really need to set resolutions because I don't like to set myself up for failure, number one, because you never know. There's always, you know, extenuating circumstances that can prevent you from finishing a goal. But my goal for this new year is to release another Lee Aaron studio album because we recorded all the bed tracks in August, and to finish my book because I've been working on memoirs. So those are my two projects for the new year, and I don't really have to give myself a resolution because I know I will complete them. So
do you know what the album and the book are called yet, and when will they come out?
No. So the album is going to be probably completed, all the tracks, in the new year, get mixed in the spring. I can't really see the 2022 Lee Aaron album being released till the fall of next year. And then the book, I do have some tentative titles, but I don't want to tell you yet.
Okay. Have you started to do live work again? Have you started to tour at all or do any live shows?
So yes, I was in Winnipeg last weekend doing a live show. Very exciting. It was my second since COVID. And, you know, largely that's because I do larger shows, and like some of the local bars and things have opened up here with limited seating. But the larger shows, some of the provinces still have half capacity. And for me to go and do those shows, I kind of need a certain amount of money. And if I'm not affordable, I can't really work right now. So it's slowly opening up. I've got two shows coming up in January in Alberta. I was supposed to do them in October, but they got postponed because of COVID, unfortunately. So yeah, it is slowly starting to open up and I'm excited because, oh my gosh, I miss playing live so much. So,
And we are getting some bands from overseas now in the UK again. Alcatraz, for example, playing on the 1st of December with Girls School. So Kip Winger is doing a solo show. So he's coming from the States. So we're starting to get some international shows again. So the other thing about what you said you wanted to do last time I spoke to you, which is a festival, is that it's open air. So maybe you can in the summer try and find an open air festival or something and come over and see us.
Well, that's my goal. The next time I come back to the UK, I want to do a festival. Yeah. So if you have any you recommend, definitely message me through Skype. I thought of it, what that candy is. Turkish Delight.
Oh, I love that. It's Turkish. It's not British. It's Turkish.
I thought it was a Brit. Well, you know what? Purdy's imports it, and I thought it was from England. I don't know. So Turkish Delight. It must be Turkish. Anyway, that's like my favorite Christmas treat.
Oh, I love that too. And you know, it's not that bad calorie-wise either. It's not too bad compared with chocolate and some other things. So yeah, that's a great choice. And that kept everybody wondering as well. So that's fantastic. you remembered just before the end of the interview.
I haven't had my second coffee yet. That's my excuse.
It's quite early over there.
But you know what it is? I always associate that particular treat with the first Chronicles of the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. The Chronicles of Narnia. Because it's the treat that the White Witch offers Edward, right? I'm well-versed in those C.S. Lewis novels. My kids loved them. So, and they loved the movies when they got to be old enough. So, yeah.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Lee, for making some time to talk to us. We do hope we get to see you next year. Love the Christmas album. People should definitely go out of their way to hear it if they haven't heard it. And we're looking forward to the new studio album next year as well.
Well, it should all be up on Spotify by the end of the week. So it'll be, you can stream it, or if you want a hard copy, if you go to my link tree on Instagram or Facebook, there's a bunch of different retailers that are carrying it right now as well. So yeah, get it for Christmas.
Thanks so much.
It's always so much fun talking to you, Dawn. Look at, we're like the Bobbsey twins today with our leopard as well.
Oh yeah, yeah, wow. I didn't notice that. That's fabulous.
Anyway.
Thanks so much.
All right. Merry Christmas and God bless. You guys take care. Okay.
Bye.